Good evening. Welcome to our parent evening, School Safety, a Shared Responsibility. My name is Dave Acklin. I'm excited to be here. I hope everyone is too, to be informed and understand what we're going to be presenting to the kids and how we're going to be training the kids, which obviously is very important. I know it's difficult with jobs and family and prior engagement, so I'm glad to see everybody here this evening. Before we get started, a few housekeeping notes. Bathrooms located behind me over here, my right shoulder. If you could just please put your cell phones on silent or vibrate. Obviously, if you have to take a phone call, it's going to be pretty informal evening. We understand families, emergencies. If you didn't already, help yourself to the water in the back, and then there's informational flyers as well on there. This presentation is going to be recorded as well. It's going to be put up on the district website at some point. So for any parents, any families, friends who are unable to make it this evening, please tell them. There's going to be a link to the presentation. There's also going to be a link under school security, a quick link, I think it's called, where it's already up, and there's going to be resources and websites provided that are going to be mentioned in the program that I strongly suggest and urge you go to and look at. There's some powerful, some great information on a lot of the websites, a lot of the information I'm going to talk about tonight. So definitely take advantage of that. And if you could hold off with any questions until the end of the program, we are going to have a Q&A at the end. Where myself, some of the community leaders, other individuals, we're going to be up here and we will accept questions and answers then. I would like to take a few moments to recognize some of our community leaders for attending the event and being able to make it here tonight. Mayor Mike Summers, in the background there. Superintendent Dr. Michael Barnes. Is the assistant superintendent here? No. Chief of Police Tim Malley, Lieutenant Roger Warner, Roger. Sitting back there by himself. Okay. School board members, Board President Ed Favor, Vice President Linda Beebe, Emma Petrie Barcelona, Betsy Shaughnessy. And I'd also like to thank all the Lakewood City School staff members and teachers, principals for being here as well. For this program, it doesn't happen overnight, and putting it together takes some time, some effort. And I would like to thank now, I usually do it at the end, but for time purposes and reasons, and I don't want to forget anybody, hopefully, I would like to thank some people who helped me put this program together. Lakewood School Security Director John Crane, and his site supervisor, Laharm Patterson, Christine Gordillo, House Principal Bridget Furstenberger, for IT assistants, Doug Bunsey and Dan in the back, Randy Hatmaker and his crew for setting up the cafeteria and making it look nice. Chief Malley and Lieutenant Warner, Lieutenant Warner is my supervisor in the Special Ops Division, for allowing me the freedom, the responsibility, and the time to take on this endeavor and really let me do what I enjoy doing and love doing, and that's working in the schools and working with the kids and the children. I'd also like to give a thank to Benjamin Armendariz. Where's Ben at? Ben, stand up. Stand up, Ben. So Ben is our, keep standing, Ben. Ben is our intern. He's been with us for, I think, about 6 months. And he's finishing up at Baldwin Wallace. Ben is an IT genius, as far as I'm concerned, a whiz. And he's looking forward to getting into police work and crime analytics. He showed me a presentation that he has put together. And Ben is just about to finish up. He has to take a semester off for certain purposes. But Ben is in the, he's looking for a job. So if anybody, just giving you a plug, Ben, okay? If anybody's looking for somebody who is computer savvy, smart, ambitious young man, that's the guy to go to and see. So thank you, Ben. Sit down. And I'd like to thank the members of my division, the Special Ops Division, for helping me through this process with this program and previous years. Like I said, I couldn't do it alone. I needed their help as well. So briefly, I've been with the police department for 17 years. I grew up in Lakewood. I went to Lakewood schools. I actually graduated from here in 1995 with a couple people, Emma, Heather Pesek over there. So it's good to see some familiar faces. I worked basic patrol for 8 years. I held the position of field training officer and reserve officer. For the past 10 years, I've worked in the special ops division, working bike patrol primarily in the schools as a DARE and school resource officer. For some of you, you may not even know or be aware of it, but with the DARE program, myself and George Rash in the back, we teach 5th grade and 7th grade, and our main office is here at the high school. So we have a constant presence in the schools and are able to have interactions with the students, which I believe, and statistics will say, have a huge impact, not only on school safety, but on a personal level as well, because the students get to know us and form a relationship with us. I've been an ALIS certified instructor for approximately 6 years. I also am a CIT officer, crisis intervention training officer, for the last 3 years, where we went to a 40-hour training, specialized training, in dealing with mental health issues and de-escalation skills and techniques, which is probably one of the most valuable trainings I've been to, along with a school resource officer. And unfortunately, but fortunately, I've had to use those skills and those techniques on multiple occasions in the schools. Along with being an OPATA certified instructor, I have attended many training sessions and given multiple presentations on internet safety, prescription and over-the-counter drug use, and opiate addiction. As the title states, this is a shared responsibility. We do not expect you, the parents, the school district, or the first responders to take this endeavor alone. With the help of everyone, we want to make our students and our families safe and prepared in the case of any event, school or not school related. Our presentation tonight is going to cover what ALIS is, what we have done with Lakewood City School staff members and why it's important to know that, and what we are planning for in the future here with our students. There are going to be some safety tips and talking points to have with each other and certainly your kids to engage with. I'm a firm believer in not avoiding the issues, but at least trying to have an open dialogue with your kids. These kids are smart, they pay attention, and they want to know. And I'm going to touch a little bit on that later in the presentation. They want answers, and we as parents, teachers, first responders, as adults, we must provide those to them. Now, for approximately the last 10 years, we have been working with the school district on the concepts of lockdown and its transformation to ALIS. Pat Fiorelli has been there every step of the way. Pat, you just gave me a one-page bio. Usually it's several pages. Okay, short and sweet. Pat is a 29-year veteran of the Lakewood, Ohio Police Department and the current unit commander of the West Shore Enforcement Bureau SWAT team. As a Lakewood police officer, Investigator Fiorelli has held numerous positions within the police department, including field training officer, uniform investigator, plainclothes detective, narcotics detective, and motorcycle officer. Investigator Fiorelli is currently assigned to the Special Operations SWAT Division as the SWAT commander and the lead departmental trainer. Investigator Fiorelli is a recipient of numerous Lakewood Police Department commendations and medals, including the department's highest honor, the Medal of Honor, for disarming a gunman after an exchange of gunfire. In 2015, Investigator Fiorelli received national recognition for his contributions to training and the police SWAT community, and was awarded the John Coleman Award of Excellence by the National Tactical Officers Association. Investigator Fiorelli is an Ohio Peace Officers Training Council certified law enforcement trainer, subject matter, expert on police SWAT team administration, response and tactics, advanced firearms instructor, active member and advisory board member of numerous professional police training associations. I'd say Pat knows a few things. So I'd like to introduce Pat Fiorelli.
Just talking to the microphone.
Yeah.
Hi, folks. You can hear me okay? All right, I've been on the range all day, so my voice may be a little scratchy, but I'll do my best here to make sure that you all hear me. I got a few bullet points up here that's going to help make this thing run a little smoother, but I think it's very important that as a parent in the Lakewood school system that you understand that we've been addressing this problem.
If you want to move around.
Okay, if I move around. I'll just stand here to make it easier for the guy with the camera. That we have been doing training in the schools for quite a long time. We've been training the police departments. Listen, in 1999, a lot of things changed for us in law enforcement when Columbine happened. And I vividly remember where I was at when Columbine happened. And as I was watching it unfold on television, you know, one of the first things that was popping through my mind was, why aren't they going into the building? There was a lot of policemen standing outside, and we got somebody inside of a school shooting people. And what is everybody doing on outside of the building? So on the heels of that, we decided, listen, we need to really start changing up on how we're going to do stuff as a law enforcement agency. And, of course, this transformed everybody across the whole country. So we started stepping our game up and deciding, listen, we need to really do something proactive. So we started training not only the Lakewood Police Department, but our interactions with all the western suburbs, because if something like this happens in Lakewood or in Fairview, we're going to need to rely on other agencies. So not only did we train the officers in Lakewood, but we married up with all the other cities that would also respond to Lakewood and make sure that everybody was on the same sheet of music. So this training's been going on for quite a long time. And as a citizen, you may not even know that's been happening. But either annually or biannually, we are doing this specific type of response training for all police officers. And that has changed a lot over the years. As these events have changed, we have also amended how we're doing our training also. Starting in around 2007, I started going into the schools and doing the staff training. We recognized that, listen, this is an event that we need to really condition people on how we need them to respond. I need the stage set so when the police come into the building, we don't live in here. And there's some things that proactively that the staff can do to help separate themselves from this problem. And the problem's not going away. And we all know that. We all watch television and we see what happens. So there was some paradigm shifts, not only in how we did business as law enforcement, but also in how we were going to start training the staff. And there was a couple things in our world that made these changes happen. And one of the most important ones was Virginia Tech. When Virginia Tech happened, we realized that, listen, we need to change things. Things need to happen differently, because before Virginia Tech happened, if you remember what happened at Virginia Tech, we were basically conditioning people to, listen, you lock your doors and we'll come and save you. Well, because I analyze all these events as they happen, and we continue to do that all the way up to Parkland, and I'll talk to you briefly about Parkland also, the most recent one that everybody really is very aware of and is very upsetting because of some things that happened during Parkland that folks maybe don't understand that I want to try to explain to you. But when Virginia Tech happened, as I look back and analyze how we were training people, we basically were conditioning folks to hide underneath desks. And it was a failure. Because we had young men, and I hate to be sexist, but we had young men that were in college that we could have sent off into the military to fight for the country that were basically programmed and conditioned that, listen, if this happens, lock the door and hide under a desk, and the police are going to come and save you. Well, it was very evident that wasn't going to fix the problem, that the individual that was creating this havoc also knew how the response was going to be, and he responded accordingly and basically was shooting young men underneath the desks, if you remember when that happened. So with that came this evolution of what's called ALICE. And all this ALICE is, if you've never heard of ALICE before, and I'll explain it here in a moment, it does nothing but provide options. It's very difficult for us to provide a cookie-cutter answer to this problem. So we have to be able to provide some different options for folks and basically put the ball back into their court to a degree and to help set up the stage for us when we respond to separate them from the problem that's going on there. Now, the Parkland school thing. Listen, when I remember vividly when there was a shooting at Success Tech in Cleveland, and I got a phone call about on the heels of Success Tech. You remember when Success Tech happened in Cleveland? When some young man went into the school and brought a gun into the school. You know, do we need metal detectors? And the simple answer to that is, listen, in my opinion, listen, metal detectors are window dressing. If I went into the school bad enough, you know, we're going to get into the school. And what most folks didn't know is they had a metal detector at Success Tech, and it didn't solve the problem. So we need to start doing some stuff that's proactive. So we started to change our approach to the teachers also. And we introduced the ALICE concept to them. And we have also done a lot of other training with something that's called Rescue Task Force. And this is kind of a very progressive principle, because what Rescue Task Force is, and as a Lakewood resident, you can be very proud, because the Lakewood Fire Department is basically leading the entire state in this concept of Rescue Task Force. And what Rescue Task Force is, listen, if there's an event going on in a business or in a school particularly, that the firemen don't have guns, okay? And for them to rush into the building would be kind of foolish. Would you all agree with that? So, but the problem is that there's people injured inside of this building, inside of this school. And depending on their injuries, they may not be able to survive very long without some immediate care. So the Rescue Task Force principle is one where the fire service changed their response protocol specific for the problem of the active shooter. And what they do now is we have them outfitted differently, where they have body armor, and they have a ballistic helmet, and they have what's called a go bag. And this go bag has life-saving equipment in there for individuals that are maybe seriously injured or have gunshot wounds. And what they're doing is the firemen are going into the building, which we consider to be a hot zone in our world, with a policeman or two acting as their security, and we're bringing them into the building before the building is even remotely cleared. There could still be an event going on in the building, and their mission is to immediately render aid to people. So this concept is very progressive. And we have been training this concept in Lakewood with the fire department for the past 2 years, and we have a very good program. Now that program is being mirrored across the state, because other fire services and other law enforcement agencies are realizing, listen, this is the way we need to do it. We can't wait outside. Just like back in Columbine, we can't have the cops waiting outside. The police are the only people that can separate you from the problem. They have to get into the building. And back in the days of Columbine and after Columbine happened, our training consisted of the first four policemen that showed up would get together and they would go inside of the building. After Virginia Tech happened, we can't wait for four cops. We got to start training it now, that the very first policeman that gets there needs to go into the building. The paradigm shift for us for training and for conditioning the officers was that is totally contrary to how we train the police. It'd be like a burglary call, and we're sending somebody in to look for somebody that broke into a building. Why would anybody go in there by themselves and do that? But the philosophy is, listen, if we don't send the first policeman into the building, the minute that they get there, every second there could be another person being injured. And so we have to send him in. So we had to amend our training, and we had to get different equipment for that to put them in a better position of success. And the chief of police and the mayor set us up to make that happen, and we trained all the policemen in that. And then we in turn trained all the western suburb policemen in this principle of solo officer response. So let me touch on Parkland. You know, one of the things that you all saw on television and you're hearing on TV right now is, you know, did these policemen wait outside? Was it a DARE officer or the school resource officer, did he wait outside? You know, is that happening? I can assure you that in Lakewood it's not going to happen, because our people are trained up. We don't know all the facts of what happened down in Parkland. We don't know what the facts are with that policeman down there. And quite frankly, I really don't concern myself with that. What I concern myself is what we're doing here and how we're prepared here. And I can assure you that this principle has been trained by us for quite a long time as a law enforcement agency. And on top of that, between the Cleveland Police Department, all the Western Suburb Police Departments, the Metro Parks, anybody that would remotely even come into Lakewood in the event that we had an event, they're all on the same sheet of music as we are. So you can rest assured that this has been going on. What I want to do is I want to kind of give you a little background on what we've been doing with the teachers, to kind of give you a foundation and how we've basically, as I like to think of it, as conditioning. It is training, but under extreme stress, what I need them to do is I need them to default to what is going to be their lowest level of preparedness. Because under great stress, and we'll all have to agree, that if something critical was going on inside of a school building, that the people are going to be under great stress. And we need them to default to a specific level, because we know that they're going to default, and we want to get them to that level. So we've been training the teachers, and we've taken in various steps. In the past couple of years, we've stepped up our game quite a bit, and if you talk to any of the teachers, they'll tell you that the training is getting a little bit more reactive. I guess. And what we did this past year, and I'll talk about it here in a moment, is that we set up some scenarios. And the scenarios were somewhat intense because we wanted to try to, I wanted to see if this conditioned response was going to be appropriate, and also to give them a little bit of a confidence builder that, yeah, you can respond to this thing, and this is what we want you to do. So what I want to do is I want to show you a very short video. Now, this is a video that we show all the teachers in their training. And listen, it's not going to be anything scary or bloody or anything. And we actually, what we did for this group was we amended it a little bit from what we show the teachers. Because what it is this is a nationally recognized training video for responding to threats in the workplace, whether it be a school or an office building. And it's conditioning on responses is what it is. So we're going to watch this quick video, and then I'll move on from here.
It may feel like just another day at the office, but occasionally, life feels more like an action movie than reality. The authorities are working hard to protect you and to protect our public spaces. But sometimes bad people do bad things. Their motivations are different. The warning signs may vary, but the devastating effects are the same. And unfortunately, you need to be prepared for the worst. If you were ever to find yourself in the middle of an active shooter event, your survival may depend on whether or not you have a plan. The plan doesn't have to be complicated. There are three things you could do that make a difference. Run, hide, fight. First and foremost, if you can get out, do. Always try and escape or evacuate, even when others insist on staying. Encourage others to leave with you, but don't let them slow you down with indecision. Remember what's important, you, not your stuff. Leave your belongings behind and try to find a way to get out safely. Trying to get yourself out of harm's way needs to be your number one priority. Once you are out of the line of fire, try to prevent others from walking into the danger zone and call 911.
Yes, sir. What's your to Washington? Help us! Help
us! If you can't get out safely, you need to find a place to hide. Act quickly and quietly. Try to secure your hiding place the best you can. Turn out lights, and if possible, remember to lock doors. Silence your ringer and vibration mode on your cell phone. And if you can't find a safe room or closet, try to conceal yourself behind large objects that may protect you. Do your best to remain quiet and calm. As a last resort, if your life is at risk, whether you are alone or working together as a group, fight. Act with aggression. improvise weapons, disarm him, and commit to taking the shooter down, no matter what. Try to be aware of your environment. Always have an exit plan. Know that in an incident like this, victims are generally chosen randomly. The event is unpredictable and may evolve quickly. The first responders on the scene are not there to evacuate or tend to the injured. They are well trained and are there to stop the shooter. Your actions can make a difference for your safety and survival. Be aware and be prepared. And if you find yourself facing an active shooter, there are three key things you need to remember to survive. Run, hide, fight.
All right, so Dave is also gonna show a couple videos. Now let me be clear on this. This is not a video that we show to the children during their training. My role in this whole thing over the years has been I train all the adults. I train the staff. My job is to get the staff prepared for, because even with the program that Dave is going to introduce to the children, the staff inside of the buildings are the leaders. Those are the ones that are going to be making these critical decisions on how they're going to handle the building and the lockdown and et cetera. And what is ALICE? You know, if you haven't never heard of it, if you've heard of it before, really what ALICE is in its essence is providing options. The alert component is the lockdown component. That's if there's an event going inside of the building, it goes out over the loudspeaker system. And we've had many discussions on this, we've had many drills on this, and we've practiced this a lot in the schools so that everybody's familiar with how to do it. It isn't one person that can do the lockdown. Any staff member can do this lockdown. They don't need permission to do a lockdown. So the announcement will go out over the loudspeaker that there's an event going on that requires a lockdown. And then the information component is critical to that and how much information they can get out so the staff can respond appropriately. And we've addressed this problem on numerous fronts because we know that we're dealing with kindergartners where a teacher could have 25 babies, basically, in that room. And is it going to be appropriate for them to evacuate? And in what instance is it going to be appropriate for them to evacuate the building? And how are they going to handle that, if everybody understands that whole part of that? And the difference it would be if you're in the high school and you have a bunch of 17-year-olds in the class, and how are you going to handle it? When we do the training at the schools, which we've been doing for years, I go into the school with Dave and the rest of our staff from Special Operations, and we go to every single school to do our meetings at the school. We don't do it in one building. We have to do it in the schools, in my opinion, because there are specifics to every building that the teachers need answered, and that's why we go into the buildings. And we talk about their rooms. We talk about how the doors lock. We talk about how to get out. We talk about where they should go to if they have to evacuate. And if they can't go there, then they need to go to here. And we talk about all the options involved in that. And we go over the dynamic of if you have to evacuate with 25 kindergartners, we all know it's going to be like herding a bunch of cats, and it may be difficult to do, but we have to create how we're going to fix that problem and how we're going to do it. So we drill that, and we practice that, and we discuss that. And the time has definitely come, in my opinion, that the time has come now, because the staff has been fully prepared for years, it's time to introduce this concept to the children, to give them a little ownership in this thing. And that's where Dave and his crew comes in, because and with working with the teachers, is this has to be an age-appropriate introduction. So the classes that we'll do at the high school are going to be different, obviously, than the classes we're going to do with the little children, because we don't want to scare them. The same discussions I have with the teachers when I go into these every year. Listen, I'm not here to scare you. I'm here to prepare you. Yeah, this stuff is scary. And we wish we didn't even have to have these conversations, but we do. And we'd be foolish not to. But we're going to have them. And I'm not here to scare you. I'm here to prepare you is what I'm here to do. So that's what we do. The counter aspect is a last ditch thing. And we have a lot of conversations about that with the teachers, and we look at the classrooms, and we look at things that you can counter with. And we have a lot of discussions about that. And the teachers understand that, you know, God forbid we'd ever have to do that, but they have to be prepared to do that. Because I don't want them hiding underneath the desk. If you have to get out of the building, and it's appropriate for you to get out of the building, then separate yourself from the problem. If you can't get out of the building, then lock yourself in. One comforting thing for them is, listen, it's Lakewood. We have a lot of policemen working here, and the response times are some of the best response times in the whole state of Ohio. There's going to be policemen showing up here. And on top of that, the teachers understand the same thing I'm telling you folks. It's not back 10 years ago where we would have four policemen would wait till they got the fourth guy to show up. The very first policeman that shows up at the building is going in. Every policeman has an ID card that is will get them into every Lakewood high school. I'm sorry, every Lakewood school, not just the high school. Every school we can get into. Just like the ID that I have that I touch on the magnetic thing to get into the building at the police station, I have one that's in my wallet right next to the one for my police stuff to get into the building, gets me into every Lakewood school. So we're in like that, just like a staff member. So it's important. And of course, there's the evacuation component to separate themselves from the problem. When we talk about the staff meetings, you know, I direct them, listen, ask questions. If you don't feel that you want to ask the question now, then you need to send John Crane an email, and then we'll come back. And we've done that a lot. Where what happens when we do these staff meetings, it's been my experience, is that it starts to solicit a lot of thinking. And they start to think about stuff, you know, when, what about now? Because I tell them, we can't hang our hat on the fact that this is going to happen at the best time of the day, if it happens. What if it happens at the worst time of the day? What if it happens at dismissal? What if it happens at lunch? What if it happens when you're all in gym? What if it happens, you know, at the beginning of the day? You cannot think it's going to happen when you want it to happen, because it probably will not. We've done a lot of other stuff with the phones. We practiced the phones. We found out, listen, with the new school system, in the very beginning, there was a couple hiccups with the phones. They were immediately fixed, and then we tested them again, and they all worked flawlessly. So, I mean, it's all good stuff, and that's why we do this, is to prepare. I explained to the teachers, and I'm explaining to you folks, that if we're going to think that it's never going to happen here, then we're setting ourselves up to fail. Listen, statistically, it probably never will happen here. But we're gonna prepare ourselves in the event that it does. And there is something called rising to the occasion. It's nonsense, is what it is. You will default to your lowest level of preparedness. And we tell the teachers that if you do not take this seriously, that there's nothing I can do other than to try to convince you that, listen, these preparation skill sets that we're trying to give you also translate into your personal life. Going to the bank machine, going to the grocery store, driving around anywhere, you need to be aware of your surroundings and to think through these things. So that's the kind of the training that we're getting to them. We tell them about pre-planning their responses and to think through these things as they go through their day. So in the event that they're in between classes, that if something does happen, that they have to do a lockdown, it isn't the first time they've ever thought about it. So they default to a level that they know how to do that. If a door requires them to put a key into it to lock it, have you thought through where you got your keys? And understanding that putting a key in a door is a very fine skill set. Like punching the numbers on your cell phone is a fine skill set. Not a gross motor skill, it's a fine motor skill, and those things degenerate under stress. But you can defeat that by practicing it and understanding that, so it's very important. I already told you about the cookie cutter responses. We don't want to do that, because we know in my business that when I'm training the policeman, I tell them, listen, everything is about exposure. The more that I can expose you to stress, the more that I can expose you to an incident or an occurrence or something that happened to some other police department, that exposure is an experience for us, and we can learn from that. We're not going to judge them. We're going to learn from it. And to tell the teachers the same thing. Listen, this experience is going to be valuable to you, probably invaluable, because experience is always something that you're going to get right after you need it. And we want them to try to have it beforehand. We have had some, I guess you can call them success stories, but we have had some incidents in Lakewood where after we've trained a teacher, we had a teacher in the Lakewood school system. We were doing it, was it this year, Dave? It was this year. We're going into one of the schools, and one of the teachers came up and told us that the training that we gave them could have possibly saved her life, because she was at the, remember when the incident happened in Las Vegas where the guy was shooting from the casino? She was down on the ground when it was happening. And she ran and did a lockdown. And she said that she went to exactly what we told them to do. Once she got herself locked down, she immediately started to step into place of what we trained them to do. She was conditioned for this, that she wasn't going to be satisfied with just locking herself into this room. She started to think about what was next. And I'm going to start going my plan B like right now before I have to go to plan B. And she started to think through the process. So the training did actually come to fruition for her, and it can for all the other teachers also. This scenario training, when I first started doing the training for the schools, I went in and we had lecture-based stuff. We talked about stuff, and we walked them to their classrooms. And then there was a building block step. And in 17, we actually took them and we put them into a scenario to try to get them their minds wrapped around, listen, here is some hands-on training for you to better condition you for this response. And then in 2018, we stepped our game up quite a bit. And we actually put them into a scenario where we had simulated gunfire. We didn't fire blank guns or anything like that. We had an audio system that we had set up in there. And what I was trying to test them was I needed them to respond appropriately to the stimuli that they were hearing. And they did. They actually performed very well. And we actually had the media come, and they videotaped it. So I'm going to show you this last video, and then I'm going to step off, and I'm going to turn it back over to Dave and John Crane. This isn't about scaring you. It's not about making you paranoid. It's only about preparing you.
Because the difference between a peaceful day at school and a deadly one is small.
Time is of the essence of these things. They're over fairly quickly.
Lakewood Police Officer David Ackland says he's been doing emergency crisis training for almost 5 years. He says just last year they went from presentations to hands-on scenario training. It's intense. And school security expert Kenneth Trump says the key is making sure participants don't try to do too much.
Even in the highest profile shooter cases across the country, where teachers have had the opportunity and time to lock down, shooters don't get access into those rooms.
Remember, the policemen coming into this building, they're responding to the sounds of violence.
Officer Ackland says his ALICE training allows people under attack to counter or fight back if it gets that far. But it also encourages them to get out of the building if it's safe.
We are empowering the teachers and the students to make decisions.
My 15 seconds of fame up there, News Channel 5. Actually, it worked out pretty well. They contacted Christine Gordillo prior to, and she contacted me. Obviously, I got the approval, and it worked out well for everybody involved, the schools, the city, the police department. And we got a ton of positive feedback from the staff members and the teachers, and a few faces in here shaking their heads. And, you know, that simulation was, you know, kind of on the smaller scale. You know, we put a lot of time and effort into it. We wanted to try and do some more, but just because of logistics-wise, but it really got the point across that we wanted to, and like Pat had mentioned, to condition the teachers in that regard. Next up, I'm going to have John Crane, Lakewood Security Supervisor, Lakewood School Security Supervisor, and George Rash come up here. John Crane is a graduate of Lakewood High. He was a Lakewood police officer and detective from 1972 to 1999. He's been the Lakewood City Schools Supervisor of Security from 1999 to the present. It's almost like a second career, John. He's also a part of the First Ring Security Directors. There's 16 school districts, and they meet every month. They discuss security topics. Basically, a good information sharing is what it is. George Rash, like I mentioned before, he's the other DARE officer and school resource officer. George and I split up the elementary schools, the two middle schools, and then, like I said before, our office is at the high school. George has been with the Lakewood Police Department for 28 years and has been instructing working with DARE and School Resource for the last 13 years. So John, George. John and George, they're going to talk briefly about what the schools have in place, security measures.
Good evening. How are you? Can you hear me? I'm not going to use the handheld mic, so. So I've been with the school since 1999, and I work very closely with the police department, the fire department, and the rest of the city, doing our best to keep students, staff, and visitors safe. Lakewood High School especially is like a little city in itself, so it gets pretty crowded up here on a daily basis. So I'm just here to tell you some of the things that we've already got in place before we get started on what they're going to train the kids with. We started the see something, say something thing after Columbine. You have to encourage kids not to be worried about being a snitch. If you think that's not hard to do, it's very hard to do, because they think everything they tell you, they're snitching on somebody. And you got to drill home to them that they're keeping people safe by telling us things. And it's taken a long time, but they're telling us more and more each year. So it's really paid off for us. We started last year the Stop It app. I don't know if you've heard us talk about this before. That's where a student, staff member, or even a parent, if they download the app, which is free, they can go on to our schools. We have the middle schools and the high school, and they can text us anonymously tips of maybe they heard something's going to happen. So when they give us that tip, it immediately goes to a designated group of people that are on the list, that the text goes to them immediately, and then we decide, do we have to act now or can it wait till morning? And we can text back and forth with whoever it is that's contacting us, but we don't know their number. Now, the sad thing is that some of the kids play games with us, and what happens then is we have to contact Stop It, and if the same number comes up at Stop It, then we have to block that number. And the kids have been told that. We have a 24-hour hotline. That's been in effect for many years, and students have called that and reported some things, and they get a voicemail. And then once they hang up the phone, it calls my cell phone, and I get the voicemail. Now, sometimes I'm not real happy because it's like 2 a.m. or 3 a.m., but if it's important stuff, then it's not bad. But then I decide, do I need to talk to the police tonight? Can I wait till morning? Sometimes we've had things come in the middle of the night because the kids told their parents something, and they waited till midnight to tell them. So then when they called, we acted on it, and we have stopped some things from happening because of those calls, okay? The ALICE training, a minimum of, 10 years or more, we've been doing ALICE training. And listening to Pat talk, it brings back memories, but the staff was a little reluctant when we first started this. They were a little nervous, and that's not odd because it's something new. But this past year when we did that scenario with the shooting, and I've been around gunfire my entire life, so I know gunfire, okay? My heart was beating when they turned on the gunfire in those speakers. And I'm telling you, the staff responded well, and they were scared to death. I will tell you right now, they were scared to death. So it worked out well, and everybody performed well. And they learned from that, and that's important. A lot of places don't have that. So it's nice that we have such a good relationship. We put some door signs up this summer for this year because we had a problem where kids are opening the doors for people. You know, you teach kids, be nice to everybody, be respectful, but don't open the door for them because it's a school building. And that's hard for kids to understand. You tell them to be nice and you say, hey, don't open the door. So we had to put signs up to remind them. So you see stop signs on the outer doors, on the inside of the outer doors, that tell people, do not open the door for anyone. Even if it's a student, don't open the door, because you don't know why that student's out there in the middle of the day. They might have gone to their car and gotten something. We don't know. They got to go to a certain door to come back in this building, and we'll determine if they were outside for a good reason or they were outside when they shouldn't have been, or for a bad reason. So that has worked so far. We're only in school about 6 weeks now, but the kids have gotten it. We went to the assemblies. We explained it to them. They got it. We've had a couple times where they let kids in, and discipline was assigned, and they didn't like that, so I'm assuming they won't open it again. The cameras that we have 779 cameras district-wide. We have 266 just here at the high school. So everything is being recorded. We don't kid anybody. We tell the kids, you're being recorded. So if you do something crazy, we're probably going to have it. Some kids don't believe us. They find out the hard way. And we're working very hard to get our cameras to the Lakewood Police Department. We're hoping that once we get that done, they will have active cameras for all our schools, and they'll be able to see live if something's going on. That is a great tool for them. If they can see what's going on, if the dispatch can see and let the car responding know, person's on the first floor, person's on the second floor, over by room 200. It's really a great tool to have, and we're hopeful that that's going to happen. Evacuation sites. Every building has two. Now, you might not know what they are, okay? Your principal does. So whatever school your child goes to, the principal knows what the sites are, but they each have two. Some are other school buildings. Some are parks. It's just to get them away from the building if they have to get away in either direction. So if you can't go east, we have a place west. If you can't go west, we have a place east. Every building has two, and that's important to know. If something would happen where we had to get a hold of you because we have to evacuate a building and you have to go pick up your child, I'm hoping that all of you have furnished us your cell phone numbers, your home phone numbers, your mail address, because through our Blackboard Connect, we can contact you. We will send you a text, a voicemail, whatever it takes, and it'll tell you that there's an event going on and where you should report to pick up your child. This is very important. So if you have not furnished us your cell phone numbers or your home phone numbers or your mail addresses, you should do that. And I will tell you that one of the things that we have happen a lot is it's not updated. You have a cell phone number you gave us last year, and maybe you changed the number, and nobody told us. So you have to make sure that we have the correct numbers. And I'm telling you, that happens a lot. So make sure that if you change your phone numbers, you contact your student's school and get us updated on that, just in case. Our relationship with the Lakewood Police Department, the Lakewood Fire Department, and the City of Lakewood is the best. There's other school districts that I know would love to have the relationship that we have with our city. We ask for something, we normally get it. They ask for something, they do get it. And that's how we help to keep these kids safe. We need to share things so we can make sure that the kids are safe. They assist us in monitoring, and they come in and I talk to these guys almost daily. But they tell me when they see something that doesn't look right and they said, you know, you should change your plan. Add this to your plan. That's really important. I go around to the buildings and I do safety checks and I look, and sometimes we change things. These guys, I don't hit everything. Let's be honest about it. So it's nice to have extra sets of eyes that are paying attention when they go in there to teach a class and they say, hey, you know, you might want to do this. So this works out very, very well for us. Now I'm going to let George Rosh talk about the Marks radios.
Thank you, John. I'm going to be speaking to you on the Marks radio very briefly. Really, the point that I'm up here for is to tell you that we are introducing tools, the schools, first responders, the city, we're introducing tools all the time to try to make our schools, our children, our staff, and ultimately our community safer. Little tools, big tools, it doesn't matter. Pat mentioned a couple. Dave said some things that were individual tools. The Marks radio happens to be a very important one because the Marks radio cuts down on time. Now, why is that important? Every second when it comes down to one of these incidents, it is critical. So if it cuts just 5 seconds off, it's invaluable. The Marks radio was developed originally after major events like Columbine and Sandy Hook and things like that all happened. It was designed to help law enforcement throughout the states okay, to speak to each other, to communicate with each other. But after they started to have more and more of these school incidents, everybody said, hey, look, this belongs in the schools too, because it's taking time for our schools to let us know that something's happening. So the Marx radios were then introduced into the schools, and basically just about every school district in the state has them now. What they're designed to do is this: instant communication with the dispatchers of every single department, sheriff's department, or any kind of law enforcement agency that's tied up with the school district. Basically, it's this. There is a unit that is placed into each individual school building. That unit is usually placed, in our case, it's always placed in the office main common area, so that not only can the secretaries and the principals, but either any teachers or any other staff, including janitorial staff or kitchen staff or anything else, can get to it and activate it. It doesn't require them to have special knowledge, though we do teach them exactly what they have to do. Big orange button, you slap it, okay? That's all you have to do. It instantly bypasses having to dial on phones or, trying to get through CCOM, which is a whole other thing involved with your cell phones. But the whole point is that it instantly goes to dispatcher. The dispatcher doesn't even have to talk to you. They can hear for 60 seconds everything that is going on within that range of that speaker. And that is the entire office. After that point, the dispatcher has the ability then to communicate to whoever's in that office. But if they're already locked down or evacuated, it doesn't matter. This dispatcher already knows and can hear what's going on in that area. The dispatcher, as soon as they get a hold of that alarm, and it's an alarm that goes directly to their columns, is that they will dispatch officers. That cuts down on time. And that's really what it's all about. Seconds. It doesn't sound like a lot, but it is. Not only cuts down on time, but it helps us to focus where the problem is, especially if there's communication with the dispatcher from school staff at that point. We can then pinpoint more accurately where those officers have to go, what they need to be prepared for better. More information always makes us more able to get to the problem, separate that problem from the innocent, and then hopefully stop that problem at that point. It's not just the Marx radio, though. Like I said, every single school has it. It's not just for that individual school. Every school in our district will hear that that alarm went off in what school. It will actually tell them that it's at Roosevelt or it's at Harrison or wherever. They will know that there is an incident going on, and they then also can prepare and be more ready just in case something else happens, or they'll know why kids are showing up at their school if that's one of the rendezvous points. So, guys, what it comes down to is seconds and minutes. It helps us to eliminate those, and they were in every single school. They were tested. They work. They're very effective. Along with things like the badges for the police officers, that's something else that we have just recently, last few years, introduced. Each individual officer gets one on their person that they carry around with them every single day they are put on the uniform. So seconds are everything here. The Marx radio cuts out many, many seconds, if not minutes. They're very effective, and it helps everybody to know what's going on, not just the police. So thank you very much. And I'll turn it back over to Dave.
Thanks, George. Okay, now the student training, the student portion. As you can imagine, and we've kind of commented briefly before, the student portion has to be more sensitive and more information-driven. Most of the information I'm going to cover and the videos I show will be shown and discussed with the students. But again, it will be grade level specific. A quote from one of our former presidents: in a moment of decision, the best thing you can do is the right thing, the next best thing is the wrong thing, and the worst thing you can do is nothing.
That's not good.
Oh, I don't need this. I'm already late.
Somebody will come. Anybody out there?
Do you have a phone?
No. Sorry. Somebody! Hello? There are two people stuck on an escalator and we need help. Now, would somebody please do something?
Help!
Help! Help! Help!
I don't believe this. You gotta be kidding me.
I'm gonna cry.
Well, there's not enough left to do, is it?
Hello? Hey, don't worry about it. I'll fix it in a second.
He said he can fix it. All right. All right. That's more like it. He says he can fix it.
Walking down the sidewalk, kicking my feet. I like that video. You know, it shows if you're faced with a situation, an everyday situation, like going up an escalator, or driving to work, or using your phone, if one little piece of information, if one little thing happens or occurs, how are you going to react? Are you going to react like them? If you're driving to work and the road is closed, do you have a pre-plan on where you're going to go, on what you're going to do? Now, these obviously are just small little examples, but kind of give you an idea of how to pre-plan in an emergency situation. So the goals is to educate and inform, not to scare. Pat mentioned that before. I'm going to walk around a little bit with Where's Mr. Walter? My Britney Spears mic. They bust out and dance and get winded. We obviously mentioned it's going to be age appropriate. Obviously, how we talk to the elementary kids is going to be way different than how we talk to the high school kids up here. Just so I have an idea, raise your hand if you are a parent of an elementary school child, preschool through fifth. Raise your hand if you are a parent of a middle school. High school. All right, it's good. It's good balance. Some of you probably have one in each and a couple in all over. I mentioned the students want to know. In the last 3 weeks, and school's been in session for I think about 6 weeks, the last 3 weeks, I've been asked on two separate occasions, and at the end of last year I was also asked, by a fifth grader, 10 years old, and she said, Officer Acklin, when, because we started doing DARE. She said, Officer Acklin, when are we going to start learning how to secure our classroom? When are we going to start learning how to barricade? 10 years old, fifth grade. I said, that's a great question. I said, we're going to be starting doing that soon. Then a couple weeks ago, I was asked by a ninth grader. She came up to me and she said, Officer Acklin, you know, we do these lockdown drills and plan and prepare. What if I'm in the hallway and there's a lockdown drill or something happens and I go to the classroom and knock on the door and they don't open the door? Because we obviously teach them, don't open the door because you might let in the threat. I said, what do I do? They don't let me in. Where do I go? So that student was pre-planning, was already thinking of what she was going to do in the case of this incident. So then I kind of, you know, I briefly went over with her, well, you're going to find the closest open room, you're going to try and lock it. If there's a lock, you're going to put stuff up against the door. If there's a bathroom close by, you're going to go in, you're going to stand on top of the toilet, not be seen, all this stuff. But I was impressed by that. So they're aware. I don't have to tell you this. I have three kids. They're very, very small. I have 2.5-year-old twins, boy-girl twins, and a 6-month-old baby boy. So I'm going to be sitting in your seats eventually a few years down the road. But these students are craving information. They want to know. They're aware of things. They are aware of what's going on. They watch the news, social media, all that stuff. And it's very, very important and critical that you have a discussion. So back there on the table, if you didn't already, there's some talking points to have with your kids, elementary, middle school, and high school. On the website, when I mentioned the resources, have a discussion with your kids. And later on in the presentation, I'll talk a little bit more about it. But you have to have an open dialogue. You have to answer questions and not bury your head in the sand. Signs and indicators to be aware of. We're going to discuss that a little bit too, because that really is the critical background component to it. What leads up to that? In the parkland that Pat mentioned and talked about, there were signs that people missed, people didn't take serious. So we just want people and the kids really to be talking about things. Our plan is to start this in January, and we're going to do grade level assemblies, first grade, second grade, preschool, all the way through 12th grade. It's going to be multiple officers, myself, George Rash, and most likely Angie Ortiz, who's one of our community ward officers. All three of us, ALICE trained, ALICE certified, we'll be going in to the preschool through fifth grade, and then probably Officer Matt Wintrick, another community officer, will assist on the middle school and high school. And we all will be on the same page, same sheet of music, talking about exactly what we're going to be teaching the kids. As Pat mentioned, it was a building block for the teachers. That's why I wanted that relayed to you, was that we just didn't start and throw the teachers into these scenarios. And I've been asked a couple times, are you doing scenarios with the kids? I heard that you guys are going to be firing off blank rounds. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. Maybe in the future we'll build up to that, but just like with the teachers, we had to, you know, take little baby steps. And this year is going to be a presentation, is going to be a discussion, question and answers, and go over it with them. So the situation scenario thing is down the road. It'll be important, but right now we need to build it up. So what are we going to do? All this talk. Well, I also get asked questions about why we're going to do this. I don't think that really would be any more questions. We do tornado drills. We teach the kids to stay inside in case there's critical weather outside. We do fire drills. If there's a fire inside a building, there it's a leave, exit. And I always kind of fall back on stranger danger. I teach Safety Town in the summertime, and don't we always talk to our kids about stranger danger and what if a stranger comes up to you? What are you going to do? Well, you're going to kick, you're going to bite, you're going to yell, you're going to scream, you're going to run, you're going to fight. Okay? It's the same premise, the same concept. We're not going to tell our kids, sit in the corner and wait for a stranger. We don't want them to be static. We want them to be moving. So I pretty much relay it back to that kind of same message. The lockdown drills. Kindergarten through 12th grade, we practice lockdown drills. We go in there. John goes in there. I go in there. George goes in there. And they do, I believe it's 4 a year. And we do it over different time periods. We do it at lunchtime. Beginning of the day, end of the day, just to kind of keep them on their toes. So for preschool and through fifth grade, you can imagine that was the age appropriate. That was the tough part. You know, our number one concern is the safety of the students. And when I was putting this together, I did a lot of research, a lot of reviewing information, watching videos. I talked with other departments about what worked, what didn't work. And you know, what it really came down to is the simple, most basic strategy of just talking, just having that open discussion and that dialogue. I wanted the strategy, the instruction to prepare the students for the worst, really without provoking anxiety and fear. That's not what we want to do. Like I said, as a parent myself, I know what to talk about, and as a police officer, I know what to talk about in regards to safety with an adult, a student, and you know ways to go about it. But how do you relay certain information to these little kids? You know, a first grader, 6 years old, kindergartner, 5 years old. So, what did I do? I went to the experts. Who were the experts? the teachers. So over several days, I sat down and I met with kindergarten teachers, first grade teachers, second grade teachers. And we discussed and we went over different kind of ideas. And I had some ideas, I had some things I wanted to run by them. And once I had their approval and we had it squared away, I knew we were good to go. Because who better to talk to the kids than their teachers, who are in classroom with them every day, all school year long. So, what I did was, I found this book, and it was put together through Alice. And it's called, I'm Not Scared, I'm Prepared. What we're going to have the teachers do is, prior to us coming in, they're going to sit down and they're going to read to the kids this book. It's about 30 pages long, and it is an excellent, excellent book, in my opinion. The author, Julia Cook, worked with, collaborated with the founders of Alice, Greg Crane and Lisa Crane. It was an Amazon number one bestseller in 2015, and it really is an instructional storybook that is child-friendly. The teachers and parents, this is available on Amazon for about $10. And we're fortunate enough, and with the chief's approval, we ordered and paid for books. We bought a book for every single grade level in every single school in Lakewood. So the teachers are going to read the book to the children, and I talked about coming in and having us read to the kids. I thought, there's no better way. I come in, introduce myself, sit down, and I read to the kids. But then, where's the focus going to be at? It's going to be on me, right? It's going to be on me. And we don't want that initially. So the teachers are going to read to them, are going to discuss with them, and try and get some thought-provoking, some problem-solving, critical thinking, and questions from the kids, okay, to kind of prepare them. It really is concepts in a non-threatening way. Then what we're going to do, shortly thereafter, probably within a couple days, an officer is going to go in, and there's the video version of the book. We're going to bring the video version of the book. It's roughly about 10 minutes long. And we're going to stand up. Sure, we're going to come in, and then we'll let them ask questions about policemen and all that kind of stuff and get a little comfortable and familiar. And then we are going to go over the video. And what I like about the video, it's a couple kids reading from the book, and we can stop it when we want to, pause it, discuss, answer questions, and all that. Because, as you know, especially if you have little ones, you have a very short attention span. So we need to get in there, we need to, you know, get the information relayed, answer questions in, you know, 20-minute period if we have that. So, this is a short, little 2-minute video version of the book.
Talking to children about a violent intruder can be very challenging, scary, and hard. I have a book that might be helpful. I'm not scared because I'm prepared. The purpose of this book is to enhance the concepts taught by the Alice Training Institute and make them applicable to children of all ages in a non-fearful way. By using this book, kids can develop a better understanding of what needs to be done if they ever do encounter a dangerous someone. Unfortunately, in the world we now live in, we all must ask ourselves the essential questions. What option do I have for survival if I ever find myself in a violent intruder event? The teacher at the Ant Hill School wants her kids to be prepared for everything. One day she teaches her students what to do if a dangerous someone is in their school. Class, my teacher said to us, we need to learn a new drill. It's called the sheep, the shepherd, and the wolf. So get ready, here's the deal. I'll be your shepherd and you're all my sheep, so you must do what I say. Pretend there's a wolf in our building and we need to stay out of his way. We need a great plan of action in case we start to get scared. The Alice plan will work the best to help us be prepared. The A stands for alert. There's a wolf in the building. The L says we need to lock down. The I says inform, because we must tell the others when we've seen the wolf around. The C stands for counter. If the wolf sees us, we must do things to ruin his day. The E stands for evacuate, which means leave the building and run away. My teacher gave us a great gift today. She taught us how not to be scared. There's wolves in our world, but we know what to do, and now we are prepared.
Kids learn lockdown, noise, movement, and distraction.
For more information on I'm Not Scared, because I'm Prepared, please click on the button below.
Okay. So, Angie Ortiz, I had mentioned her before. She's one of our community officers. She actually just shared a story with me last week. Her little girl just started kindergarten this year, and a week into the school year, they had a lockdown drill, and she got a call, I believe, from the teacher, or I don't really recall. She got a call, or when her girl came home, and she was, her little daughter was kind of scared, was freaked out a little bit over, you know, the lockdown drill and what was happening. And, you know, the teacher did what they were supposed to do and locked the doors. And, you know, if there's a bad guy coming in, that's why I like this. It says, you know, a dangerous someone. I like the verbiage good. And Angie looked at me and she said, I'm a police officer. I'm an ALIS-trained certified officer. And I did not talk to her about this prior to it. And so I talked to her about this book. She ordered it the next day for her daughter. So I think it's a great tool, a great book. If you would look under your chairs real quick, and if you have a yellow golden ticket under your chair, go ahead, everybody, look under your chairs. If you have a yellow golden ticket, take a look, take a peek. You really got to look. I kind of put it up there. Look, make sure you look. Here we go. Here you go. You got yourself a book. All right, I think this was also an important part of the book that I really liked. It was in the back. There are 10 talking points that parents and teachers can discuss with the kids. And the teachers, obviously, they know what to do. We're going to go over the book with them. They have the concepts already down. But these are great points for you as well. There was a couple that I wanted to highlight. In a counter situation, when the secured location has been breached by an intruder and evacuation is not possible, the best line of defense is to have kids up, moving, making noise, gaining distance, throwing items. So I don't want you guys to think that, I know you understand the whole concept, but I don't want you to think that we're going to be teaching the kids to go after and chase after a gunman with a stapler or a book. This is going to be in a last resort, you know, save your life encounter. So some questions and some fears and concerns over the counter concept of ALIS, especially with the kids. And I just want to make sure that that's clear, that that's absolutely a last resort. Upper elementary students, middle school, high school, have developed more critical thinking and problem-solving skills and should take a much more active role in ALIS than the children in elementary schools. And I'll touch on the middle school and high school here in a little bit. The special needs students, actually after we conduct these drills and plans with the teachers, I ask for feedback, emails, if you have questions, concerns. And I got two places that I got multiple emails and questions from, and that was from the cafeteria workers and from the special needs instructors and teachers. So what I did was, and George, we went back, we went over, we talked to them about what to do, what not to do. So the teachers are preparing, they're planning, and we went over with them what their options are. Education and empowerment are the keys to preparation and relieving fear. The middle school and high school obviously is going to be different. We're going to go in and we're going to speak to the kids about the concepts. We're going to discuss it with them. We're going to show a video to them, and I'm going to show it to you here in a minute. It's about a five-minute video. And for a lot of, a lot of learners, you have to appeal to different people. If they're, visual, auditory, whatever. Visual, I think, is the best option. And in this video I found, which I looked over many, really went over each of the ALICE concepts, what to do, and can give the kids an idea of what they need to do. I'm going to get rid of this. I'm going to take the mic. Okay. Of what the kids need to do. And we're asking the teachers that if the kids want to take part in it, they want to practice. And when we do the lockdown drills, we already tell the teachers, you need to use this as a discussion point and go over the kids. We're going to do this if this happens. We're going to do that if this happens. So hopefully, the teachers I know have been discussing with the kids already, and now we're going to give them those options and that information. So there's been much research and studies done on the causes of acts of violence and school shootings, and four major causes they found were unhealthy addiction to technology, high drug use, inability to deal with stress properly, and parents not being involved enough. That's why we talk about discussing it with the kids and answering their questions. We need to make sure that they feel safe, that they know we're doing our best, the city, the schools, to keep them safe. They may need assistance in separating reality and fantasy, and I don't have to tell a lot of you probably about social media, about video games, about music, all that kind of stuff. And really, you need to have your finger on the pulse of what they're doing. You really need to be involved and stay involved. I went to a training over the summer for police officers and school personnel, and they talked to us and showed us about Grand Theft Auto video game. I don't have older kids. And then some music rap music videos that were being shown, and it was unbelievable what these kids are doing now. So you really need to stay on top of those things.
All of your teachers and school staff members have been trained in a program called ALICE, which stands for Alert, Lockdown, Inform, Counter, and Evacuate. The goal of the program is to give teachers and students many options to respond proactively to any life-threatening situation in the school building. As you learn more about the ALICE program, it is important that you pay close attention. The most important pieces of the ALICE acronym are ALERT and INFORM. If you see something that you think is a danger to anyone in the school building, tell a teacher immediately. It doesn't have to be your teacher, just tell someone. Some examples of things to alert a teacher to are weapons, fights, or suspicious activities anywhere on school properties. Your teachers can then use the PA system to inform the rest of the school of the safety concern. That means that you need to stop and listen every time you hear an announcement, because it could be something urgent and important. Announcements will continue throughout the incident to keep everyone informed, so it is important that you listen to every announcement. Your teachers want to keep you safe, but your safety depends partly on following their directions. If a violent event does occur at school, the best defense is to evacuate the building if it is safe to do so. Evacuation may not always be possible, though, because of where the violent event is taking place. Again, listen to your teachers and follow directions. Unlike a fire drill, when you evacuate from a violent event, you will run out of the building following your teacher. If evacuating is not possible, the next best option is lockdown. This is not the old-fashioned lockdown you have done in the past. Instead, you will be fortifying your classroom using the shelter-in-place technique. This involves quickly building a barricade in front of the classroom door to prevent anyone from getting in. Barricades don't have to be complex, but they should cover any windows so that nobody can see into the classroom. A good barricade can be constructed in less than a minute and will prevent anyone from opening the door. Your teachers have practiced this and are very good at barricading, so listen carefully to what they tell you to do. It is very important that you do not open the door for anyone, no matter what. Once you have sheltered in place, you still need to be ready to defend yourself, just in case an intruder makes it into your classroom. This is called countering the attacker. After your barricade is built, stay away from the door and pick up something that can be used to defend yourself. If someone makes it into the room, defend yourself by throwing objects at them. Use things like textbooks, shoes, or staplers. Your classrooms have plenty of useful objects. Do not stand still while you do this. Move around the room and make noise. Most of the time, attackers will retreat if they are met with resistance. Sometimes, however, an attacker may get too close for comfort. When this happens, do anything you have to do to bring that person to the ground. If there is a weapon, avoid it. It is much easier to bring someone down as a team, so work together. Once you get the attacker on the ground, hold him or her down forcefully by placing one student on each arm and leg. Hold them there until police arrive. If a weapon is present, do not touch it. Your teacher will know what to do with it to prevent any injuries from occurring. Now that you know about the ALICE program, let's review. ALICE stands for Alert, Lockdown, Inform, Counter, and Evacuate. Here are the main points. Be sure to alert a teacher if you see or hear anything dangerous or suspicious. Listen to all announcements because they will inform you about situations in the school. Listen to your teachers and follow all of their directions as quickly as you can. Evacuation is the best defense. If you can safely evacuate, run to the rally point following your teacher. Your parents can pick you up there later in the day. If you can't evacuate, lock down by building a barricade and being ready to defend yourself. If an attacker makes it into your classroom, counter them by moving around, throwing objects at them, and bringing them to the ground. Work together and don't touch any weapons.
So that, I think, pretty much covers a lot of the basics and steps that we want. So we will go in, and then we will talk with them in regards to each step and answer any questions they have. The high school, they're obviously going to have strong opinions on school violence and causes. We learned that from Parkland and the students involved after that going around speaking. And across the country and the nation, really, even up here at the high school, they had several rallies, speaking engagements where we worked with the schools to make sure that they got their point across and that everything was safe. So they're definitely going to have their own suggestions on how to make schools safer, and we need to listen to them. I mean, we need to listen to the kids and what they have to say. Bottom line is, when we talk to the kids, it's to follow the instructions of their teachers. Their teachers are the leaders. They are going to direct them in any unpredictable situations. What we need to make sure we do is emphasize the role the student can have in maintaining the safe schools. Following school safety guidelines, like John Crane had talked about, not allowing strangers in the building, report any dangerous threats or information, bullying, threats of suicide, threats to the school, communicating any personal safety concerns to parents, administrators, school resource officers, and give them and provide them access to resources, which I think we have in place. This is a video from the Sandy Hook Promise Group, and they've gone around to the schools and then worked in the schools in here for the last couple of years. And they started after the senseless tragedy in Connecticut. They're focused on gun violence, school safety, and signs, symptoms, and indicators to look for. It's important because our kids are the ones that are going to see the signs. They're the ones on social media before any of us see it. So I'm going to play through this. It's a pretty good video.
I got some news today from the radio man. He spoke the words somber and as softly as he can. The world stood still and the sky opened up. I made my way to fill up my coffee cup. Then it occurred to me as the daylight sky shone blue, today's the day that Johnny met June. He waited a while, he knew that he would. He was gonna hang around here for as long as he could. The days went by, and hours idle passed. He was never sure just how long he would last. But there's not much love in a lonely room. Today's the day that Johnny met June.
Have a good summer.
You too.
Thanks.
Hey, you must be bored.
No way.
This is the guy that I was running to in the library.
You're kind of,
yeah.
Like guilty. So.
Oh my God.
So you like to write on desks?
Yeah, that's what I do.
So it really seems sad that, you know, showing a video like that and looking at it, those are just little small indicators, little small signs that kids, you know, see. We've gotten reports and information up here working at the school. They saw this on Instagram or this posted on Facebook, and we commended those students for giving that information. And, you know, 99.99% of the time, our follow-up, our investigation, it turns out, you know, okay. But it's better to give us that information, present us that information, whatever the case and the form it may be. And a lot of those things that, you know, I hate to say it, I don't have to tell you, they do happen. You know, you have the bullying incidents, the stuff posted online. So, okay, just some more talking points. Answer any questions. You know, elementary school, be brief. Let them know that the adults are there to protect them. And talk to them over examples of what's going on. So, in conclusion, there's a quote that I found from a teacher, a third grade teacher in Alexandria, Virginia, who learned about Alice in his own staff training and called his 7-year-old daughter's school and asked leaders there to transition away from a lockdown approach. While, yes, statistically speaking, I quote, the chances of a shooting are slim. I don't want, heaven forbid, something to happen to my students or my daughter and to say there was a small chance it would happen. And it happened. No one ever planned for it. This is the reason why we are all here today. As parents, educators, first responders, it's our duty to educate, to protect, and help our kids set goals and reach those goals and dreams. As I said before, school safety is our number one mission, but it is not something our kids should have to agonize over, fear, or affect their ability to effectively learn and grow and to be students and people. Okay. So before we open it up for questions, I'd like to thank everyone for your attention. If you want to take a screenshot of this is George and mine's email, phone numbers, in case you have questions, comments, concerns after today, which I'm sure there will be, please feel free to give us a call. Email is probably a better way to get a hold of us, but either one. And, you know, we will answer your questions the best that we can. Everyone get that? Did I go too fast? Back. That, so like I said, this is going to be on the website. This whole presentation and all the slides will be available on the website shortly. All right. I know we ran a little long. I apologize. I'm sorry. I'd like to thank you. Are there any questions right now? This is the point where it's like Friday, last period of the day. Teacher says, are there any questions? And, you know, one student in the back and everyone's like, are you kidding me? It's time to get out of here. It's Friday. It's the weekend. Really? You want to be? Oh, yes. Is there homework this weekend? Yes. Ben, where's Ben? Come on up here, Ben. And you know, I had the chair set up here, but if you have a question directed to me or one of our speakers, you know, one of our leaders, please feel free. We're going to pass around the mic. Raise your hand if you have a question, and we'll come around and answer it the best we can.
I hate the microphone. As part of the presentation to the students, do you plan on talking about specific things, obviously age-appropriate, that the city, the police force, the school district, the teachers are doing to keep them safe? Because I know from my perspective, like right now my stomach is in a knot, but this needs to happen. But I went to the presentation in the spring that the city put on, and I know you were there, I think all of you spoke, and it was like unbelievable what you guys are doing. And as upsetting as this issue is, I felt so good about our city and our kids' safety. So I just wonder if, like, providing some information to them at the beginning that these are the things we're doing to keep you safe, and here's the next step. Here are the things that you can do to help keep you safe.
Absolutely. I think transparency is the key. We need to talk to the kids and tell them how we got to this point. When we got to this point, just like with the teachers and set up the building blocks. And you know, Pat mentioned it. It was several years that we just talked and discussed and gave presentations and answered questions. You know, it wasn't until recently, 2 years ago, that we incorporated the scenarios. So, yes, we plan on talking to the kids and telling them all the plans that we've had in place and that this isn't something that, you know, was just thrown together within the last year or two.
So, could we... also, thank you. Thank you so much for all of this. Could you go back to talking about whether or not you're going to use maybe live or blanks, gunfire, those sorts of sounds when you in the schools? Did I hear you say that correctly?
I said that we are not going to be doing that.
Okay.
That is a scenario. And I know some school districts, I've talked to some other SROs, and they've gotten to that point, a very few. Right now, no, logistic-wise, we are building the concepts of ALICE, of lockdown, of all that, just like we do with the teachers, and it's going to be quite some time. And you know, when we get to that point, we'll obviously make sure, we'll let parents know, we'll let everybody know, but we're not going to do that for some time, no. We're going to build up these building skills and blocks first.
So it kind of concerns me to think, just because my daughter's in elementary school were terrified when they were very young of the fire alarm. I don't know how it might be counterproductive for very young kids to have that kind of sound.
Let me speak on that. We are, and I can speak for the chief because we had a lot of conversations about that for the teachers. You know, hey, should we make this somewhat realistic for the teachers to really introduce them to this concept so they can actually hear what a gun sounds like in the school? That would have been counterproductive to what we were trying to accomplish. And to introduce that to a child, I don't care if he's 18, inside of a school setting is totally inappropriate. So we will not be introducing the sounds of gunfire or blank firing guns or anything like that. So let's be totally clear. I can assure you that's not going to happen. Because we've had many conversations about that with the teachers. Should we do this for the teachers? Would it be a benefit to that? And there's just too many things that can go south with that. So with the kids, there's 100%, we are not doing any of that stuff with the kids. Any, no sounds of gunfire, no blank firing guns, none of that. We're not going to show them guns, none of that stuff. It's not appropriate. We're trying to get them set up for success.
Thank you so much.
It's a great question, though, because we hear it all the time. We want to make sure it's clear there's not going to be any gun stuff going on at the school.
Thank you.
I just wondered how frequent the training is and how often reinforcement is done.
Well, we're going to, right now in corporate, we're going to do it, like I said, grade level assembly. We'll do it most likely once a year. The first few years, just like we did with the teachers, once we kind of get everybody trained, but, you know, you get new crops of kids in and, you know, you want to get them trained as well. So we'll keep up on it, you know, year-to-year basis. Once a year.
Hi.
Hi.
In the initial video with the office, the general video, it says run without considering what others say, as a first, if you can run, run, correct?
Correct.
Now, in the schools, I imagine that that's the decision of the teacher, not the individual student.
Well, that's going to be age-appropriate and age-sensitive. When you're talking about the high school kids, freshmen, sophomores, juniors, seniors, is the teacher going to be able to corral all these kids and, you know, tell them, you guys need to wait here? We're giving these kids the options. That's part of it. We're giving them the options to evacuate, to run. They're not going to be disciplined if they run from the teacher and the teacher tries. I mean, we, our basis is you need to follow the teacher's instructions and follow their lead. But, you know, the elementary school, they're going to probably do that. I mean, they're going to, you know, follow what they say. The middle school, you know.
When they get the announcement about an intruder or whatever, if it's locked down, it's. I mean, will the announcements say what to do, or just that there's an intruder, and then based on the situation, it's up to the teacher or the individual?
Right. As part of the ALICE, you know, the information is key. And whatever information we can get or can get out there by the school, by the staff, principals, we want that out there because every situation is you know, at best, it's situational.
Right.
Go ahead, Pat.
Because I do a lot of this training, I think I can help you with that answer. Listen, what we're trying to do here is to set both the staff and the kids up to separate themselves from the problem. You with me on that? Lockdown is their first option. It's probably their best option is to separate themselves through the doors they have in these schools, to separate themselves in that way. So don't think that there's going to be this announcement that there's somebody in the school and then everybody's going to be running out of the school. Because of the environment that we're in all these schools and the way these schools are constructed now, they're very safe. The doors are serious doors with serious locks on them. And the doors are difficult to get into for somebody that's trying to get into them because they open into the hallway. And if you know anything about construction of door, it's hard to get into that door. So we're training them, listen, the best and the quickest and the most efficient way to separate yourself from the problem is to lock down. The evacuation part of that is very far into it, and it's very situational. And the teachers know this from when we tell the teachers, listen, lockdown's your best. We're on the way, and we're in Lakewood. We're going to be coming into the building very quickly. So I hope that helped you with that. Yeah, they're not going to be running out of the building. That's not going to be their first means of their response. Okay. It's a great question, though. Absolutely. Right, the teachers, with the little kids, the teachers will. The older kids, let's be real, if it's a 17-year-old, 16, 15-year-old kid in the school, and he sees that the problem is on the other side of the school and he can separate himself by leaving the school, then he's going to leave the school. We'll get you.
Real quick, I just want to jump in and jump to the last question somebody asked about how often they were going to get this training. As it was mentioned earlier, there's four times a year that we do lockdowns. During those times, teachers are going to be encouraged to reinforce the lessons and to talk to their kids and go through all the different things that they've already been talked to by us and learned. So they're actually getting it, you know, four times plus the time we give it to them. So this is going to be five times a year. How much time the teachers have will always depend on how much information they can reinforce and go over again and build upon. but definitely it's not just one time, it's several.
I caught one mention of people with disabilities in all of that. In the book, one of the bullet points was, yes, individualized plans need to be made in place for children with disabilities ahead of time. Every one of those videos, everybody's able-bodied. Everybody seems to be having normal sensory perception. There doesn't seem to be anybody autistic in those. As wonderful it is that you guys are ahead of the curve on getting Lakewood, you know, prepared and being a shining star of how to do this well, can we maybe produce some videos that show people that are not typical, that are either as teachers or as students, everybody else's plan D is their plan A. And I'm watching the kids getting ready to throw stuff in the room. I'm like, yeah, I'm sitting back there in a wheelchair going, sitting duck. Oh, keep moving. Yeah, I can go. You know, that's not going to help me much. What am I going to be able to throw with limited upper body strength? So, and helping the kids have a sense of agency ahead of time and not see their classmates as, you know, potentially a human shield would be really nice. Also, I'm all about the prevention. You guys mentioned very early on that you've had I'm so tired, I've had a long week, de-escalation training. Can our kids get that? Can we bring that in age appropriate? Not just see something, say something, but if they're if they see that there's something going down and there's not an adult to report it to, so that they have some sense of power that they're not just, you know, bystander. Empowering them in that way, I think would really help.
I appreciate it. Thank you for the comments, absolutely. So the first part of it, like I said, I've been into the special ed classrooms and talked to the teachers, and they went over the same questions. You know, we have this autistic student who will not move. We have to give them something to get them to move, or if we have somebody in a wheelchair. So we are willing, and we did go into classrooms, and we'll go in every classroom and say, okay, in a best case, awesome scenario, world situation, we'd like to have an answer for every single thing and be able to do this. So we have to go by a case by case basis. So I walk them through, okay, this is what we can do. We can open up this window. We can have people help. You know, usually in several of the classrooms, there's three or four aides and teachers. Okay, so they're a little bit different than a regular classroom that only had one teacher. So they had three or four adults in there. And then we talked about the wheelchairs. Well, the elevator, can you use elevator? You want to use elevator? So then they had to think about, okay, what are we going to do? The one teacher literally said to me, I will pick them up and carry them over my shoulders and run out. So, you know, and as for videos, I'm sure there are videos, and it's a great point, and, you know, it's something that we're going to have to cover and talk about with them. And then your second point about the de-escalation, the crisis intervention training, I actually just last week met with the Cleveland Clinic doctor here, Dr. Wimbiscus, who's here once a week, and we set up a mental health group that we're talking about getting a threat assessment team together to put into place to discuss, to go over things. And one of it was mental health first aid training for the teachers. Now, the kids, I think it would be great. That's not up to me. That's not up to the police department. That's up to the school district. That'd be one of their questions. I would be all for it. I think it would be great.
was always a concern of the teachers. This is years ago. That topic came up. What do we do if there's a kid in the hallway? You're telling me don't open the door. I tell them, listen, common sense is going to rule. If you see it's a kid in the hallway, we're not telling you to leave the kid in the hallway. We're telling you, listen, you're basically opening the door to your castle. So open the door to the castle, grab that kid and get him in there and slam the door and proceed. Don't leave kids in the hallway. I know that's what you're thinking because, believe me, we've been through all this stuff for years with the teachers and telling them, listen, we will have kids in the hallway. The kid could be in the bathroom and this thing jumps off. You know, we're going to have kids knocking on the door. We're not saying, listen, you can't come in here. Sorry, buddy, you're on your own. You know, we're saying, listen, you're going to grab that kid and get him in there. Yes, if the world's coming to an end, could you potentially be opening the door to the person? Yes, we know that. But at the same token, there isn't a teacher out there who's going to let a kid sit in the hallway. They're going to bring him in. So your concern was addressed a long time ago. We do it every year. We talk to them about that dynamic that could happen. Okay, does that help? Right, we've done all that stuff, like the visually impaired students that we have, students that are in wheelchairs. And Dave gets to see this all the time. When I go into the schools, I learn that, hey, we've got kids that are visually impaired. How are we going to handle that? So we deal with that on a case-by-case basis. Same thing with the wheelchairs, kids in crutches, you know, all those things. We address all that stuff. But you know what's going to happen.
Are we going to have any kind of like code words for the kids so they know, have an idea what's going on? A lot of this other stuff got covered with what I was going to ask about. She took care of most of what I was going to ask. So, but is there like a code words or something that they're going to be taught so they know, say, hey, it's an intruder, it's XYZ, or if it's, you know, something, guns?
Lockdown. You're going in lockdown mode. And the kids know that. That's what we practice is the lockdown drills. If there's any, and it's not just an active shooter. It's any, it could be a trespasser, disgruntled parent. No, I'm just throwing that out there.
No, don't worry.
You know, whatever the case may be, or something on the exterior, on the outside, where we've had incidents before happen, and we will contact the school, and they will go into a lockdown or a modified lockdown, that we call it. So they're trained and they're prepared. I mean, the kids know. We're going into lockdown mode. This is what it is. We're shutting off the lights, locking the doors. So, yeah, the kids will know that. And there are some good, like I said, talking points in those flyers. And then also on the website, there's going to be some things to discuss with the kids, too.
All right, thank you.
Sure. Somebody over here.
Thank you. I have several questions, actually. The first thing I wanted to clarify is if any ALIS training has taken place as of yet, or is this scheduled in the future?
For the students?
Yes.
This is going to be just beginning. This is just happening.
Okay.
I mean, they've been conducting lockdown drills with the teachers for many years. So they know, you know, we are shutting the lights off. We are getting out of line of sight. We are, you know, preparing for an event. And then we've been doing that for many years. And that's when we've been training the teachers. And we've talked to the teachers and say, use that as a teaching moment. Talk to the kids. This is what we're going to do if this happens or if this happens. Well, now it's going to be coming from us. We're going to tell them, and we're going to kind of build it up a little bit.
I'm asking because in just reviewing some of the training material, it appeared to me that when the tornado drills and the fire drills, which I know have taken place, are given, then this is an appropriate time, according to the ALIS training, to incorporate ALIS training. So I just didn't know if my daughter had already been exposed to this training at all.
No, and that was covered. We were not starting until January of 2019, where we're actually going in and talking to the kids. But up until this point, they've done lockdown drills.
Will parents be invited to attend that training as well with their children?
I would think, to be honest with you, the logistics of it, I don't know. That's up to the schools. I mean, there's no way we could send out notifications to every single parent of every single, you know, child. But if we're doing first grade level, it'd be something they'd have to contact the schools and talk to the schools about.
Okay. With regards to blanks, and this is just me in the time I've been sitting here and watching your presentation, Ohio, Pennsylvania, Kentucky, New York, they've all been having blanks fired in the schools for training, for ALIS training. So is it just across the board in the school district that absolutely at no point in time you're planning on having blanks fired?
I mean, not for some time. No, I would say we're not going to have that for quite some time.
But it is in the plans for the future.
I wouldn't say plans, no. It's been brought up. It's been talked about.
Okay.
But there's no plans in place.
The handout that you distributed, talking to children about violence, tips for parents and teachers. So I noticed at the bottom of the page you have the last sentence, "In most children, these symptoms will ease with reassurance and..." Page one, and then at the bottom of the page it says page one of one, even though it's cut off a bit. So I followed the link to the National Association of School Psychologists. So the second page that was cut off actually reads that children, pardon me, "In most children these symptoms will ease with reassurance in time. However, some children may be at risk for more intense reactions." To continue, "Seek help of mental health professional if you are at all concerned. Children who have a past traumatic experience or personal loss, suffer from depression or other mental illness, or who have special needs, may be at greater risk for reactions than other children." So that was completely, and it goes on, there was a whole second page, including limit television viewing of these events. Limit television viewing and be aware of a television on in common areas. Developmentally inappropriate information can cause anxiety or confusion, particularly in young children. My daughter is 7, she's in second grade. You repeatedly said during your presentation that you've all seen on, you know, the news and you've all seen this. I don't watch television. I boycott mainstream media. My children are not exposed to it. And this information, I do not find appropriate for my 7-year-old daughter. So she has absolutely no idea in the world that men can come into schools and shoot children. And I should be the person who decides whether or not my daughter is exposed to that, just as Lakewood currently has curriculum posted on the website for 6th grade and up, but not below. I'll, you know, definitely find out why that is. But if this is something that's being introduced, and it sounds like curriculum to me, I really have a problem with this being exposed to my child.
Okay. I actually had this discussion with several teachers, and I said, let's discuss this with the parents and let the parents, if they want to not have their students partake in this, we'll give them that option. Multiple teachers said, we do the tornado drills, we do the fire drills, we do lockdown drills, why would we not talk to the kids about this? So, you know, that's not up to me. That's up to the schools. And we'll have a discussion after this if we need to send something out and say, if you don't want your student to partake in this, then we will make arrangements to do that. So, I mean, that'd be something fine to do, and we can talk to the schools.
I absolutely agree that the responsibility falls I completely understand the need to prepare, you know, children for the possibility of this happening. I just feel that it's my responsibility to determine when and where that happens, and that not hostile at all at the police department for, you know, teaching the children, but more so the school for not giving me as a parent, you know, the ability to make that decision for my child. I'm also curious as to whether or not anyone involved in Lakewood City Schools is either a referral partner, reseller partner, or value-added reseller for the ALICE Training Institute. I don't know if anybody could answer that question.
So what do you mean by that?
Yes.
Are we making money off of this?
No, the school district. If anyone was a value-added partner...
Nobody's making money.
I was just
this
curious.
Is something we are providing to the schools.
Okay.
So
I was just curious because I saw that their website is a Shopify website, and I'm aware. So I was just curious about that. I appreciate your time, though.
You singled out men in particular. Can I ask why you singled out men? You said
for the children to know that a man is going to come into the building and shoot up the school. Why did you single out men for that?
There has been, yeah. I mean, the percentages are mostly higher males, but there have been a few isolated incidents of females. All right. Do you have a question, ma'am?
As the students can maybe pinpoint where it's an informed type of thing. It's called iAlert or something.
It probably is very similar to the Stop It app that we have, okay, where students can report
things.
No,
it's actually when they're here, when they're active shooters in the building.
Yeah, I'm not familiar with it.
I don't know if that's something that might be something that could be applicable.
Sure.
Could be helpful. All the
we're open to any suggestions and information to,
It's called iAlert through Rocky River Schools. Yeah. But I don't know. It's something to think, look at.
Thank you. Any other questions? Yes.
I know there's a lot of substitute teachers in the buildings all the time, and I'm wondering if the training, the ALIS training that the teachers get, can be extended to include the substitute teachers.
If the school district wants to handle that, we do. We set up our trainings beforehand, well in advance, for certain days. And with the schools, I don't know with the contracts and who does what with substitutes and all that. I know they tell teachers to come there and be there. I don't know how they work it with substitutes. Mark, I don't know if you can comment on that. Mark Walters, the principal here at Lakewood High School.
Yeah, substitutes go through a training because we contract out. So these substitutes go to many different school districts. So to provide them a Lakewood-only training. However, if we have a long-term substitute, I have several in the building this year. So what we do is we actually have the video that the Lakewood Police Department provided a filming of the training that we had, and all of our long-term substitutes are required to teach it or to review it, just as our regular teachers are. So to train all of the substitutes that are in multiple districts, it would be logistically a challenge, but it is available to them. And the substitutes that are here frequently, we certainly can recommend that they view it.
Yeah, that's exactly what John said. They offer to the substitutes to come, and when the substitute comes in, they are given the keys, and they're also given an informational packet, an emergency plan of what to do if something occurs.
Do your HVAC people get training?
The ones that are in the building. My husband works in all these buildings all the time.
The custodians do. The HVAC, that's a separate company. I don't believe that they've got the training now. The custodians, everybody.
They wouldn't be responsible for children either. So.
All right. Well, thank you. I'd like to thank you for your time, attention, and have a good evening.